Welcome to Jenkins Documentation Office Hours. It's the 13th of December. Let's get started. Topics I had: news, weekly changelog, and Meg's got a question that I think is a good question we should discuss and talk through. And I don't know that I have an answer yet, but what's the difference between what should go in managing and what should go in system admin? Then I've got a question that, go ahead, Meg, what was that?
You said you note I did not write up a proposal.
Yeah, well, and that's why there's a long and painful history on that one. So let's have that discussion.
Yeah.
Pipeline Steps doc generator. That was when Kristen, I wanted to get some coaching from you on. And so we've got some tutoring there that I need to be sure I understand some things. And if Dheeraj were to join us, we could talk about modernizing a plugin, but I'm not overly worried about it otherwise. I've got lots to do on it. I've just been very busy with work that I haven't had time to play on that.
Okay.
Anything else that needs to be on the list?
I'm good.
Okay. All right. So, and by way of news, I don't have anything particular. Let's see. No, we'll talk about it in Pipeline Steps doc generator. There was a recent change to that. Okay, so weekly changelog then. Let's do the review. So this is here. Oops. Here we go. Okay, so all right. So improve file path API, JavaDoc, and JavaDoc around validation. Okay, so this is a developer topic. That means we've got an action item. Move developer topic to the end of the post, end of the list. Okay, but no objection from me. This comment, I think I propose we go take that out of the text, having thought about it. Oops, mistake. Okay, Jenkins, and this is which pull request? 6033. Well, it would help if I got to the right place. Just a minute, core. Okay, so what Daniel says is, developer, add file path. Agreeable for everybody else?
Yep. Sure. If people know, I don't know what that is. So if it makes sense.
Yeah, this is an API change.
Right.
Therefore, it is truly developer focused. And I think he's right. Potentially, we wouldn't need to include it. It's uncommon for users to care about that, but we've used developer quotes in the past.
Right.
Okay, JNR POSIX, we typically have not put those into the changelog, so I propose to remove this one as well.
Okay.
Any objections? Okay, next. The experimental option now works with, this is, again, a developer thing. Okay, right. So maybe we want to put the developer text on it. Although really, this isn't just developer, right? Because if it's, Kristen, if it's saying this as a property, that means as an administrator, I can start the thing with that option, can't I?
I think so, but we don't really want people to do that, right? Like,
yeah. So, okay. So leave it as developer, or do you think we should? Yeah. Okay. Are you okay with leaving it as developer? Or should we propose that it be skipped?
I'm okay with leaving it as developer because I feel that if you're, because it's like, what is it? You know, like it's the option where it's like if some power user is doing it, but we don't really want people to use it.
Right. If you're exploring that exact option, this is the way to do it. If you don't need to explore that option, you're probably endangering yourself by doing it.
That's what I read from this. So it's like, I'd rather.
Okay.
And the fact it's, what does it mean that it's called experimental? Does that mean that it is an experimental feature that a year from now we might tell administrators how to use it, right?
Right.
Exactly. This is what Basil's been doing is making steady progress to replace the existing thing that loads Java classes with a hopefully eventually better thing.
Uh-huh.
And this is very much experimental right now because class loading in Jenkins is very, very important. So this thing that he's doing is actually experimental in the word means it there in that case that it's experimental.
Except as I had to think twice to see what I meant, I wonder if we should say the blah option now works as an experiment, or that's not good. So the option isn't the experiment, it's the option now works experimentally.
You can turn on the experiment? Is that kind of what you're saying, Meg?
So that would work, it can be turned. It's in, you know, we're saying it's in beta status.
Okay.
So like this, is that sort of what you're saying? I'm not sure quite how to say it and get the message across. Experimenting with plugin first class loading.
That makes sense to me. Yeah. Does that sound good, Kirsten, to you?
Or is it that we need to reference URL class loader?
I don't think so, because that's probably, that might be a little bit more detail.
Okay.
I'm not thinking that a lot of people, especially if it's experimental, a lot of people, the people who are using it probably know what it is.
Okay.
So great. I'm hoping that maybe they'll Basil, if he's testing stuff or has, you know, people running through a whole bunch of stuff.
Is there a JEP for this big project?
That's a good question, Meg.
No, there is not.
Is there anything written up that we could?
It's just been evolving. So there isn't any.
Okay.
Any doc that I am aware of separate from the progress that's in the pull requests themselves.
Okay.
Okay, so is it this dash? Whoops, that didn't help at all. Sorry, this dash, plugin dash first class, I think the meaning here of plugin first class loader is not that there's a hyphenated plugin first.
Uh-huh.
Or is it? Is that what it means? Is it that it does plugins before everything else?
I think if it's first class, I think if there's a dash at all, I think it's between first and class. But
see, that's the part that has me perplexed. What now I've got to go find out. Okay. What is the Java doc of this thing say? I've never read it. I've seen it mentioned. Okay. Yeah, so it uses jar and classes before the core class loader.
Ooh, okay. Interesting. Mm-hmm.
So it really is loading plugins first.
So the
hyphen is exactly placed correctly.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
So it's that
there is fascinating. This is working this way.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So
I would have thought we'd had to loot core first. But
okay. So you're all right if I alter it that way?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. and having learned something new. Now, next one, regression in, this one, we typically phrase the regression at the end of the sentence. Let's go here, read it. Oops, that was not what I wanted. Oh, because that's not the pull. Okay. The pull is this. Okay, so. Okay, newly created items are again automatically accessible to their creators.
Good.
Is that a fair way to say it?
Yes.
Okay, so newly created items are again automatically made accessible to their creators. Regression in 3.2.2. Okay, now did I damage it though? How do I include the fact that it's no, I'm gonna cancel. I've got
a wait a minute. Well, no. What about newly created items affecting the Matrix Auth plugin are again automatically made accessible?
Yeah, so my worry there is
do we have to put regression in parentheses at the end? Is it if you wanted to keep it at the end?
Yeah, let me grab this text. I'm gonna back off. I wanna read his words again because okay. I think there's something I did there that was just wrong. Okay. And so so
put them both there.
Here's the broken phrasing I used and his regret affecting the mate. Okay, so
So
is it in the context of the...
Yeah, so newly created items affecting the Matrix Auth plugin. Just insert that after items, and I think you're... It looks to me... I'm not understanding what it is. But.
Yeah, I'm almost reading this as like it was something that the reason we found it is because we saw there were issues with the Matrix Auth plugin.
Right. Like, so.
Does that make sense? Cause it's like, cause this is something in Jenkins core. So it would be a fix for that. And then we happened to find it because of Matrix Auth. And that's why we're.
Yeah. Well, it. And I think we owe it to ourselves. Let's do some quick reading.
Okay.
He gives us a nice link to his. All right. So. There was a change made in to do use listeners.notify and it started failing these tests. And that's notice the Matrix Auth right there. So Matrix Auth depended on something that could not have this called in exactly this way. Okay, so newly. Again, automatically made accessible to their creators. So is it to prevent an issue with the Matrix Auth plugin? See, I'm not sure I'm saying it well enough. More coaching.
What if it's the regression with the Matrix Auth plugin? What we don't know is if this affected anything else. Or just...
Right, yeah. I'm reading this. It seems, yeah, it's a fix and regression. Yeah, that sounds okay.
Yeah, that looks good.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
I mean, it's using the word regression twice, but it's not obvious to me how to make it better.
No.
Okay. Especially if we wanted to keep progression at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like just a...
Which is the pattern, right?
Oh, great. That's important. That way people are skimming, they can see that.
If we don't put the parenthetical regression in, then we have to work the 2.324 into the main
sequence. Right, and then every other case where we've put the regression on the tail in parentheses, it now is out of sync. So
right.
Yeah. Okay, I'm game with going with this. Thanks for your patience reading it. Next, then. All right, so filtering now hides unavailable updates on the updates tab in the plugin manager. Needs a full stop at the end of the line, but other than that, I think that's okay. Is it, wait a sec, is this really on the updates tab? Oh, no. I remember this one. Let me double check. I've got to see this on a real Jenkins installation, sorry. Because it's in the plugin manager. I actually was one of the ones who tested this interactively. Oh yes, it is in the updates tab. Okay, so the problem was, if I was in the updates tab and an update was available and I started filtering with some text, it would apply the filter except for updates that could not be installed because they were too new. So, okay, so now I remember, and all it's missing is the updates tab is correct. Okay, so full stop. All right, next then. An agent to controller security measure failed to persist configuration.
I think we need, it's like, okay.
Usually we like them to be present tense. Any hints on how to phrase that to be present tense? And
because it's a fix too, right? This is a bug, and I think we should.
Yeah, it is.
That we.
So.
What if we flip it around? Configuration is now.
I can see that, Meg. Yeah, because it's doesn't really.
Is present or. Configuration. What was it with an agent to controller when there was something failed that blew the configuration?
Well, though, it just threw an error and it didn't save.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what we see is, hey, failed to fully this was the error it threw.
And then
it didn't save the result. So.
Ah. So. Configuration is maintained after an agent to controller security. Ooh, issue detection.
Okay.
The problem was that it had detected an issue in the agent to controller security, right? The agent was trying to transfer something that it wasn't allowed to.
Retain agent to controller security configuration.
When
saving, when,
well, it was because it failed, right?
I think it's, well,
there was an exception.
Just very confused. Yeah,
so
failed to persist a rejected callables text, no such file exception. So it's like not saving the error message, so it's just throwing something instead of notifying that there was something that was, because I'm reading this like secrets rejected. So it's at least like there's an error. It's just saying for some reason that it's not letting you.
Because what it,
it's not saving a log. Maybe.
What's supposed to happen, isn't it? Isn't it like with in scripting, is the administrator supposed to get a list of things that the agent attempted to do that it wasn't allowed to?
Yeah.
So that they can go in and change the.
Let's go look and see. I don't know. Okay, so this was merging security fixes, And then he says this, that change would be obsoleted by this. Oh, okay. So this, the one that he says it's obsoleted by has not been merged yet. Okay, so, and here it says callable rejection config through an error rather than persisting anything. So is it that, an attempt, I'm not sure I understand. So it's based on the stack trace, it's trying to append something to a config file. So it's trying to remember something. And in this case, the thing it's trying to remember is the allow list. So it's, or no, it's trying to, it's asking, go ahead, Kristen.
Yeah, say, because I see it says fully read secrets rejected.
Right, so this is whitelisted, is probably a negation, right? So it's checking that's not whitelisted, not allow listed. Okay, back to the text. Retain the agent to controller security configuration when saving.
Is it really configuration, or to me it's, I'm in so far over my head, so it's all done. But if I try to, if my agent tries to send something to the controller that's not allowed, that's not whitelist or not on the allow list and not standard, it's supposed to get written to a list, a file that the admin can later review and say, oh, that should be allowable and add that, right? And that's what it sounds like to me. It's not getting added to that list.
Right.
Not actually, which I don't think is configuration.
Right.
Well, and that, okay, good point. So
it isn't what I think of as configuration.
Unless this thing is read later. If this thing is later used as a list, and it could well be.
Just like it seems that the file is maybe not there. So, or if it's like, yeah, text read. So it's, yeah, no such file exception. So the.
Yeah, so it's that when the file did not initially exist, the attempt to append failed because there's nothing there to append to.
Right. So, but it wasn't configuration. It was the thing didn't get added to the list.
Right. Well, I agree. So we should take out the.
Which technically is configuration, but it's not what we.
Well, see, the piece that I'm not sure of is usually Jesse, when he would phrase something like this, if it had just been a log, he would have called it log. And so my suspicion is that I bet this thing is read. That it's later read and used as effectively a data store.
Well, right. That's probably how they found the problem in the first place. It's probably, he was like, wait, I know this should be rejected versus the file. That's right. Probably how he found it. But I kind of agree. I agree with Meg though, a little bit, because it's not really a configuration until you can either approve or deny it, which is why it's kind of a little, I don't know, because if I'm reading this, I see this as a configuration. It means that I tried to set something and it didn't work versus what sounds like a standard error that just kind of happened, or you know, the agents doing their thing.
I think separate for a log, that the agent to controller thing creates a list that then the administrator can go in and look and choose things to. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think happened. It didn't get written to that list.
So you're thinking, say something like this, rejected callables list.
I
just feel weird saying configuration because it's not something that until you go and select the things, I don't know, it doesn't seem.
Agent to controller security violation.
Okay.
Is now properly added to the list or something.
So you're saying add a agent, something like that. And maybe we say rejected callables.
Let's call the name of the file just in case.
uh,
security rejections. I would call it a security violation, but I might very well be wrong.
I'm sorry, say that again, Meg.
I would call it a security violation, but I might be wrong.
I'm not sure that, okay. Because I don't know that in this case, it's a violation in that sense.
Exactly. I think it's just rejected.
This is saying, hey, the code detected you're not allowed to do this, and it's reporting that you're not being allowed to do it.
Okay.
Right. Like, I'm not entirely sure we should call it violation yet.
Yeah. And it is, because it is violated the rules that are currently set up.
Okay.
And I think there's a list that the administrator can go in then and quickly click and say, no, I will allow this. But I'm not.
Okay. Well, we could certainly go read the code. I'm now at the point where I'm not confident that I'm doing a good job of rephrasing. Are the two of you okay with that as a way to do it? What would you like?
It's okay. Do we have the option of going back to Jesse and saying, can you clarify this, what this is?
We certainly do. We can just leave it text as is and say, hey, let's ask for his help.
Yeah, because Jesse's pretty articulate, but we all write stuff.
Oops, and I think I've done damage.
No, you hit cancel.
Yeah, but is this what it was before?
Yeah, it was a little confusing. I think that's why we were at this.
Yeah, that persist configuration we got rid of fast, so that must be.
Okay, wait a sec. So, oh yes, okay, it was. All right, so I'll just let me put it into the notes. Ask Jesse for help. For help on the, and he may just snicker and say, look, it's temporary. Don't worry about it. And
that's okay. Then at least it's
that would be okay too, right?
Yeah, exactly. Because, then look, it's like, let me have a double check.
This is going to be obsolete. Quit wasting energy on it.
No.
Okay. All right. Next one is a bug fix. Okay, and it says holding custom log records softly so large record parameters do not interfere with garbage collection. Okay, instead of holding, we need something that's not a gerund, but hang on. So that is a really tiny editor. Okay. So something like. How about do not interfere? How do we say?
What about custom log records are now held so that large record parameters do not interfere with garbage collection?
Ah, yes, yes.
Are now stored, held. I don't like held, but.
Right.
And I don't know that we need to say softly. It's just we did something.
Right. I was kind of like, I'm not sure if that's like the technical.
Yeah, what is the technical meaning of softly? Really?
Yeah, exactly right. It's like, I think I understand what it's saying here, but it just doesn't, you just have this, you know, this holding like a cat, like very gently.
I was thinking of Roberta Flack killing me softly or something.
Oh, no.
Right. Okay, so how about custom log records do not interfere with garbage correction of large record parameters?
Custom now, log records with large record parameters.
Ooh, there we go. Very good.
And is it no longer interfere or?
Yes, right. There you go, even better. Like that?
Yeah, I think I like that.
Yep.
Okay.
Everybody knows what garbage collection is. We don't need to say yep. Java.
Nope.
Okay.
We're good.
Custom log records with large record parameters no longer interfere. Yeah, I like that. Okay, good.
I can dance with that.
Yeah, me too. All right. Yeah. So, and then there are some to look at to see, do any of these look like they should be in the log and aren't? None of those cause me any concern. I'm going to go ahead and run the job. Anybody else have concerns?
I'm good.
Okay, actions. Change log drafter. Run. All right. Next topic.
Are pipeline steps more important than managing Jenkins?
Actually, I don't. Well, maybe. How about, yeah, good question. This one is probably lots of thinking. This one is a pretty quick one. So let's move it down and get this one off the table very quickly, if that's okay.
Okay.
All right. So what happened was there were updates to an automated test and some other updates to the pipeline steps doc generator.
Okay.
And as a result, I ran a comparison between the old and the new, and the new now adds this. Okay, so here it is. Before this particular change, that what it was doing is fixing a test. Before this change, there was no entry for the Docker Slaves plugin. Docker Slaves is this old plugin, 4 or 5 years old, last release. Now it's included, and I think it's okay and makes it, it is appropriate that's included. I was just surprised to see it arrive.
It could be that there might have been an error that was failing before or being kind of swallowed.
Okay.
And then just we kind of like rolled with it. And maybe now, because we did a change, it's no longer swallowed. Especially if there was like certain things already there, like I wouldn't doubt that maybe something got.
And that is quite believable. That's an easy one. And let's see if, okay. And now there is changelog entry for it even. So, when I wrote this, there wasn't a changelog entry for this release. The release is now available and there is a changelog.
Oh.
So I think we go with it and say it's okay. Yes,
okay.
That should have been there before, and it is correct.
Yeah, exactly. Like I kind of want to go through, and I know I don't know who the maintainer of that generator is. They're not doing a good job keeping it up to date. But just kidding. It definitely was me. But I wanted to kind of go through and rewrite some of this stuff, how we generate some of the documentation anyway, just because I'm like, I think that it could be maybe easier to understand or just easier to maintain, because it's got some of it's kind of a little to make ASCII doc. It was very difficult, and there really wasn't anything available at the time when it was written to like easily export things into an ASCII doc, and
right. The
world has changed and updated, and I think it's more, it might be better to be able to play around, and even with all the changes in 4, there might be some better ways to do things. So I don't know, it might be time to go through and have a look at it. It's been a little while, so.
Well, but for right now, it's doing its job, and it's doing its job well.
Worried about that. Like, I'm just kind of I feel horrible. I released it, and it's like, oh, goodness, I feel
this,
horrible.
This thing's story is actually quite a good story in that it now, every week, we update this thing to depend on the most recent weekly Jenkins, and it just continues working. And there was a change just last week that an API method was deleted, an old deprecated method was deleted.
Okay.
And this was the change to fix that.
Oh, good.
And that, so it's actually being actively maintained in the sense that Dependabot is telling us, hey, this needs to be updated. This needs to be updated. And so it's actually, well, it's as healthy as any of our tools are, I think, because it's got people watching it, and when it fails, we go after it.
Oh, good, because I was worried it was like kind of lingering over on the side, and it's like, oh yeah, I did all these things. It's like, I really want to go and like make improvements or like generate some stuff and make it maybe not make it so crazily nested. And it's just kind of, I didn't want it to be a drag on our project. So I'm glad that it's not annoying.
Yeah.
And I'm glad it's not annoying people. It's kind of really the big thing.
And as far as I can tell, it is not. It's doing quite well at meeting the needs that it was originally written for. So no complaints from me at all.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, thank you,
Marcus. I did not know that you were the brains behind this, Kristen. Kudos. I think it's a fabulous thing.
Thanks. Yeah, it was really cool. Like, it operates like a headless Jenkins plugin manager. So you can actually have a plugin manager that's separate from Jenkins, and it loads everything up into itself and generates documentation. So
yeah,
that was fun. It was a really fun project, but it's like I have not exactly been the best steward of open source and keeping it.
It's quite impressive how well it works, right? So I mean,
I'm glad it's helping.
For me, I'm still enamored by this one. I just, oh no, here we go. I have to show it. It's if I go to Jenkins pipeline and I look at the pipeline steps here, and to think that this one. Here, we'll pick this one, and now I'm just going to shorten it. This thing was all extracted by the tool. I mean, it's oh yeah, it's doing its job.
Awesome.
All right.
Weak link is maintainers that aren't keeping their part of it up. Maintainers that do a good job, it works beautifully.
I know that's a lot of good documentation in the Git plugin. Lots of good examples. All right.
So ready for the hot topic then?
I am.
Okay. So this is the Mark Waite Hall of Shame that we're now going to go wandering into, because I think the reason this ever came about is because I made a mistake. So what we have is we have a section called Managing Jenkins, right? And what's it got in it? It's got configuring the system, configuration as code, time zone, tools, plugins, script console, hook scripts, agents, script approval, users. Okay, those are all about managing something, I guess. But now we look at system administration, backup, monitoring, Chef, Puppet. These things are actually configuration as code. And we've got a configuration as code over here. So Meg, think your question is leading to why do we have two sections, managing Jenkins and system administration, when that doesn't give any clarity for categorization to the reader.
True. But what I see though, is if we combine them, it would be way too big a section.
Right. So maybe there needs to be some other partitioning here, that it's not managing and system administration, maybe there's a better partitioning for it.
One thought that I had, this is trial balloon, so, was that we make the managing Jenkins be a section basically for everything that's on the manage Jenkins page on the UI.
Oh. Sort of
roughly in the order.
Okay, that would.
And that gives it a nice flow in terms of documentation. Now, is it used? Is it how people think about it? But I'm thinking that if I'm new to this, I'm going to start with the UI.
Okay.
I am, now that we've got a section on configuration as code, you know, we can start pointing through. This could also be done through configuration as code. Go look. And then, because there's something in there. One of them, it's like a list of options you can use when starting Jenkins or something. It's like, that doesn't show, you know, that's not on the page. But okay, there's managing, administration, and operating. And it seems like the three terms are used sometimes interchangeably, and sometimes they have the marketing people think they're special meetings. But
okay, so that last thing you said, I'm wrestling with it. Can I pull back just a little back to the manage Jenkins? So I need to get concrete examples. So I'm going to bring up my Jenkins instance just to be sure that I've got a specific example. Okay, so here we are, and on manage Jenkins here, We've got system configuration, tools, plugin management, nodes, configuration as code. These two, the one that's that's highlighted now is a separate plugin. Likewise, this one and this one and this one. But configuration as code, we've got so these, this one, those sort of five that form this top left corner are all, I think, already in, or are they in managed Jenkins?
Not all of them.
So tools is, plugins is.
But I'd like to make the titles exactly match what's on the screen.
Ah,
that's a good point. Because then if you're on this page, if you're looking for help.
And then the managing, the index file in managing describes the whole page.
Okay.
That you've got these and with a link to the section about them.
Okay.
Right. Okay. So that now that would then lobby. We would, okay. So that would mean that, for instance, managed Jenkins would have managing users, which it does. And in this case, it's exactly the text that's used there, right? Manage. No, it's not quite manage users. Okay.
I saw the plugins one too, right? Is there a plugin?
Sorry. What was that, Kristen?
Oh, sorry. I was looking to see if there was also like a plugins one or like
There is. It's managing plugins here, so and right here it's called manage plugins. But I think it's a good mapping. Hey, if it's on manage Jenkins the page, then it belongs in this section. And maybe do we call this section manage Jenkins? Although the others are using Jaren, so maybe it's best to keep it managing.
We could, and then it could start out the managed Jenkins screens have a lot of what you do.
Right.
Now, the one slight exception would be, if you go back to your instance that you had, the one thing down security. Now, security is in its separate section, and I think that's okay.
Well, but
I can reference it in the index file.
Well, and isn't security in a separate separate section here? Mm-hmm. This is conceptual things, not UI clicks. So right. I think it would be perfect. So this teaches you what is access control, right? And
that's right.
What's controller isolation? So these are security concepts. Whereas in managing Jenkins, if we said
we don't tell them how to
global security,
right? We don't tell them how to do credentials,
right? And then we could link there from there and say, okay, when you click configure global security, here are some choices, and the choices are described in this other section.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I can write my way around that. At least a draft of it. And now system time zone does not.
See, for me, that would move into administration.
That's right. What I'm thinking. That's not on. Yeah, I'm looking things. CLI script console, I think, are there. Groovy hook scripts would move into administration.
No, actually, I think you're right. So this is a good test. We have this thing called Script Console. Mm-hmm. And I love it. It's a great thing. Script Console is wonderful. Mm-hmm. But it's different than Groovy Hook Scripts.
Right.
Right. Script Console gets its own thing. Groovy Hook Scripts, they're sort of related to each other in that they're both Groovy expressions, but really, a Groovy hook script is actually not executed in the Script Console.
Right.
So would that be something that moves to system
administration? I would think it would. Yeah, it should probably move to system administration.
Right. Either that or it could be subsumed into the other one. But in this case, I don't think it makes sense.
Right, because that's a startup, right, Mark? Like the
hook scripts. Right, right. The hook scripts are the
startup.
There are two flavors of hook scripts, right, if I remember right. And one is, the post-initialization is the most commonly used hook script.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay.
Because, hey, when you're, as Jenkins is coming up, anything in init.groovy.d is executed as a Groovy script.
Mm-hmm.
Allows you to do all manner of dark and fascinating things with Jenkins startup.
Uh-huh, yes.
Okay, so to capture the concept then, the concept here was, all right, managing Jenkins will be reserved for items with a top level entry on managed Jenkins. So this would be managed plugins, configuration as code. Let's see.
Node management, tool configuration.
Yeah, actually, that's a good one. Let's get that phrasing exactly right. Okay, so managed, it was managed nodes and clouds. Okay, and global tool configuration. Okay.
Well, we're going to get, could put system configuration up above.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. System configuration, and probably should have those in the order in which they appear in the UI.
Right. And in the UI where you've got the matrix, so you read global tool configuration as the second thing, not manage nodes.
Sorry, what was that?
If you're looking at the system configuration block here, uh-huh. Configure systems one, global tool configuration is two.
Right.
Okay. Because some would read down the first column and then over the second column.
Oh, right. Yeah. So it at least for me, I read left to right. I was reading left to right. So yeah, you're
and
correct.
I think when I look at those, because I think tools would come before nodes, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. Let's see how they render it this way.
Tools would certainly come before configuration as code, probably.
So configure system, global tool configuration, plugins, nodes, and clouds.
Yep. That's the order. Yeah. That's the same order.
Okay.
I've got that. Yes. So that's good. Okay.
Okay. So let's get that. So it was configure system, global tool configuration. Okay. Manage plugins, manage nodes and clouds. Okay, this one is a custom plugin that is not used widely enough to justify putting it on into our top level, nor configuration slicing, but configuration as code is, we want people to use that one, so it should be there.
Right. Right.
Okay. The other two, these other two are sort of my orphans, and then are things that I happen to love, but not general purpose enough. Then configure global security. What was the other? Manage credentials.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, we could have sublists here because there are those big sections.
Oh, right, right. We should.
If you want to list them all, I'm not sure if it's your time to list them all.
Well, that's a good point, though, is that there is, in fact, a
system configuration block.
Right. There are higher level groupings, and we do our users a disservice if we don't acknowledge those higher level groupings.
Right. Well, I will when I write the questions. You have to do it in your minutes, but I'm all for it. So, and manage credentials, and we've got that one configure credential for
I don't think understand. That's a standard thing, right? That's not something I did. Yeah. Okay.
Yes, it's I don't understand it. We may not have documents. I'm going through looking for low-hanging fruit first right now, but we can mention it.
Okay.
Yeah, the pages don't have to be really long either, just as long as they touch it.
Right. Right.
Like, yeah, so as long as there's somewhere, if someone has a question, they can click on something and get an explanation about it, then that's, I consider that to be a win.
I mean, right now the configure system is content-free. So we could improve on this pretty quickly.
Yeah, so then, and so the idea is then system administration includes the rest of the things.
Anything else, right?
Right. And that means now we've got the other administration topics. And that means we've then got redirects to be created for, what do you call it? For files that have moved.
Ah.
Because today, this page, let's go to it as an example. This page has a fixed URL.
Right.
And if somebody had a hyperlink to that, they need to find this page again, even if it's moved to the system administration section.
Yes. Okay. And so I need to learn how to do those. I don't know.
Yeah. So redirects are described in the contributing guide.
Right.
And because these are top-level file redirects, they should be quite predictable.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Good.
I can stumble on. I mean, I'm not going to fret if I don't get it 100% right. I want to, but we've got the theory that we're going on, so I'll do something close and we can tweak it.
Right. Great. Excellent.
Where is Viraj? He didn't get sick, or did he?
I haven't heard. I assume he's resting. I hope so. He was actually feeling well last week, but he may also be busy with work, right? He's got a job.
Yes, that's fine. I just wanted to make sure that we didn't know he was sick and we're just saying blah blah.
Yeah, I hadn't heard of any illness for him, so we'll hope for the best for him.
Okay, cool.
So we've hit our hour. Other topics before we close?
I'm good. I can stay off the streets with this.
All right. Wait a sec. One more mistake I made. Sorry. Help me remember in the future. One of the things that needs to happen is when we've reviewed the changelog, we need to actually approve the pull request.
Oh, okay. We can help with that.
Do you want to do that in this case because of that, Jess, that one thing that we want Jesse to check?
Actually, I still want to. It's still better to have a changelog with the text as it exists now than to not have a changelog.
Okay. Yes.
And then we can always rerun it, I guess.
Reviewed in docs, reviewed and approved in docs office hours. And now I won't merge it because there may be additional changes that will arrive.
Okay.
I guess worst case scenario, if someone has a question, we can... Hopefully they'll know to ask in any of our communities, like just because it's like this, or maybe, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. If there's a mistake in it, we can revise it. If our lack of understanding is terrible, still it can be revised even after the release.
Okay. Great.
Right.
All right.
Cool.
Anything else before we conclude?
I'm good.
I think I'm good.
Okay, thanks everybody.
I'm up for next week.
I have to warn you, I'm up for next week, but the following week I am not. I intend to be gone the week of the, or during the 27th and even the week after that. I'm going to take the Monday after the New Year's also, I won't be available. So we'll meet next week, but then I'm going to take a 2-week break. If someone else would like to run it, it would be okay, but I plan to take a break.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, so I'm probably not going to be here for either of those dates either. So,
all right. So we'll talk again next week, and then we'll plot and plan for our time off at the end of calendar year.
Yes.
Sounds good.
All right.